The love of God, the faith of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you. Welcome to worship with the First Presbyterian Church of Beacon, New York, where together we are bridging worlds, encountering God, and healing lives. Whoever you are, wherever you are, and whatever your background, we are glad you have joined us and hope you find just what your soul needs today. If you have a candle with you, we invite you to light it now, as a reminder of the light of Jesus in all times and places. We continue with our prayer of confession. Holy and merciful God, in your presence we confess our sinfulness, our shortcomings, and our offenses against you. You alone know how often we have sinned in wandering from your ways, in wasting your gifts, in forgetting your love. Have mercy on us, O Lord, for we are ashamed and sorry for all we have done to displease you. Forgive our sins and help us to live in your light and walk in your ways for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. If you have water in a container, we invite you to pour the water as a reminder of the grace and power of baptism. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. I want to show you some pieces of a puzzle. Can you tell just by looking at these pieces what the puzzle is going to look like? You might be able to get an idea looking at some of the pieces about what it's starting to look like, or, you know, you could guess what might it be, but you can't see the whole picture until you put all the pieces together. And now we can see that it is a picture of the world. You know what? In our lives, sometimes we might wonder, why are we here on this earth right now? Or why do I live in Beacon, New York, of all the places in the world, and not somewhere else? Some people might ask God, what is the purpose for my life? We're kind of like these little puzzle pieces that only show a little bit of the whole picture. Today in our scripture reading, we're going to hear a story of a really brave woman named Queen Esther. She was like a piece of the puzzle, and she didn't know that she was part of a big plan to save God's people, the Israelites. But her piece of the puzzle was a very important piece. And you know what? We are kind of like those puzzle pieces too. We might not be able to tell what the big picture of our lives looks like, but God knows what the whole picture looks like, and God knows exactly where God needs us to be. God loves us and gives us all different parts of the puzzle to be a part of a really big picture of God's love and forgiveness and peace for everyone. Will you say a prayer with me? Dear God, even though we can't always see what the big picture looks like, thank you for letting us be part of the puzzle. Help us to share love and forgiveness with all those we meet. And all God's people said, amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from Esther chapter 7. So the king and Haman went in to feast with Queen Esther. On the second day, as they were drinking wine, the king again said to Esther, "What is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted to you. And what is your request? Even to the half of my kingdom, it shall be fulfilled." Then Queen Esther answered, "If I have won your favor, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given me. That is my petition. And the lives of my people, that is my request. For we have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated. If we had been sold merely as slaves, men and women, I would have held my peace, but no enemy can compensate for this damage to the king." Then King Ahasuerus said to Queen Esther, "Who is he and where is he? Who has presumed to do this?" Esther said, "A foe, an enemy, this wicked Haman." Then Haman was terrified before the king and the queen. Then Harbona, one of the eunuchs in attendance on the king, said, "Look, the very gallows that Haman has prepared for Mordecai, whose word saved the king, stands at Haman's house, 50 cubits high. And the king said, hang him on that. So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. Then the anger of the king abated. Mordecai recorded these things and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus, both near and far, enjoining them that they should keep the 14th day of the month Adar, and also the 15th day of the same month, year by year, as the days on which the Jews gained relief from their enemies, and as the month that had been turned for them from sorrow into gladness, and from mourning into a holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days for sending gifts of food to one another and presents to the poor. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, we pray your presence with us, that you would meet us, that you would speak to us of eternal things, that we would hear your word and be transformed by your love and by your grace. Amen. This book of Esther, it's a novella, a literary work that uses ironic reversal to make its point. And like any other literary work, the characters and their situations, they're relatable and touch our lives, and for some of us, in untold ways. The question today is, who is your Mordecai? Who's that one person in your life when you aren't sure of who you really are, when you've lost your way, when you don't think you're brave enough or confident enough, or you're simply too tired to go on? Who is your Mordecai? That one person who is relentlessly on your side, who will not let you go, who will not let you give up on yourself or on your purpose. We all need a Mordecai. While my biblical training did teach me to remember that all of Scripture was written for a particular audience in a particular time, and it was not written for the time in which we are reading it, there are always things that get my goat, and the story of Esther is certainly one of them. Young women being corralled and gathered up to be trained to be gifts for the king's pleasure. They had no choice. It was this or die. This is Esther's context in the story. She was oppressed in the truest sense of the word. Her youth and her beauty were not on her side, in that they ended her up in the king's court. On one side, perhaps maybe there was a possibility of a life of luxury, but at what personal cost to her? It doesn't have to be this extreme to be oppressed. Certainly, oppression does look like this, and we see it every day. But oppression can be lesser. I can't say lesser. Oppression has many forms, and it doesn't have to look like this. And each of us have our moments where in some ways we might be an Esther. Moments where life is simply too hard, where an addiction perhaps has knocked on our door and taken us down a dark road. It may be struggling with mental illness or a difficult physical illness. It may be a financial crisis, a broken family, a broken heart, a lost job, and the impossibility of finding a new one. And in our current climate, we have this daily news of immigrants searching for a better life, rushing borders, refugees fleeing by the tens of thousands just to survive. The argument over those who claim they cannot work due to the need for childcare and low wages, and those who just think they're lazy. And then there is this. Whatever it is you are experiencing right now, the weight of living life, of just waking up, can feel quite heavy on any given day. As you know, Frank's sister died a few weeks ago. It was a shock for us to learn about 7 months ago that she had become a severe alcoholic. In some ways, it wasn't a surprise because she and Frank are children of two alcoholic parents, and the medical community for some time now has recognized that alcoholism is a disease that is hereditary. And when Frank's father was laying in an alcoholic's coma many, many years ago now, the doctor telling us he had a 10% chance of living, the doctor took Frank aside and told him that he had better get himself together because he would be the next one laying in that bed. Frank was not a drinker then, and he had never been. And little did we ever guess this disease would be visiting his sister all these years later. I was working on this text for my continuing education class long before Donna died. But as we walked this journey with her, I could so clearly see these are the very things in any situation that can completely blind us from seeing the God who yearns to liberate us, to completely liberate us and free us from all the things that hold us back on this earth. And some days we just aren't strong enough. Or we look in that mirror and that inner voice tells us we just don't matter. Sometimes we believe everyone else's struggle is more important than ours. Or no one could possibly understand the complexity of what we are going through. Or worse yet, we can't face the fear of failure, the mistakes we made. So we don't ask for help, or can't accept the help that is offered. Or maybe we can't see that help is there. And this is why we all need a Mordecai, a stubborn, unrelenting Mordecai who tells us our truth, who insists there is a world that is bigger than us, that is depending on us, that needs us to go on, to fight harder, to look in the mirror and know with utter certainty God created us with a purpose. And without us, this world will not be what it needs to be. There are days we need to be told that we are loved with an everlasting love. Nelson Mandela said this: what counts in life is not the mere fact that we've lived. It is what difference we have made in the lives of others that will determine the significance of the life we lead. Even in our brokenness, and we all have brokenness, we're serving God. The book of Esther so beautifully emphasizes for us that human action is a necessary component in achieving God's purpose in the world. On any given day, we can be an Esther or a Mordecai. And whether we are oppressed like Esther was, or we are Mordecai on the outside, we can be part of God's plan for saving the world. I remember when I was a kid in my church, which I loved, you know, in the Christian Education building, there was a bulletin board, and on it was this very 1980s poster that read, "God doesn't make junk." Whether today is the day you are deep in the throes of your struggle, or today is the day you are lifting someone out of one, No, this has been true since before the beginning of time. You were created out of love. And Thomas Merton said it so perfectly. And this is a quote from him. To say that I am made in the image of God is to say that love is the reason for my existence. For God is love. Love is my true identity. Selflessness is my true self. Love is my true character. Love is my name. So to close, I would like to rephrase Thomas Merton's words for us. To say that you are made in the image of God is to say that love is the reason for your existence. Love is the reason for your existence, for God is love. Love is your true identity, regardless of how you are feeling today. Selflessness is your true self. Love is your true character. Love is your name. Love is your name today and forevermore. Please don't forget that. No matter what you're facing, no matter what you're up against, love is your name. Amen.
Could tell the world just one thing, it would be that we're all okay. And not to worry, cause worry's wasteful and useless in times like these. I won't be made useless, won't be idle with despair. Gather myself around my faith that lights the darkness most fear. Small, I know, but they're not yours, they are my own. No, they're not yours, they are my own, and I am never broken. Poverty stole your golden shoes, but it didn't steal your laughter. And heartache came to visit me, but I knew it wasn't ever after. We will fight, not out of spite, but someone must stand up for what's right. Cause where there's a man who has no voice, there ours shall go singing. My hands are small, I know, but they're not yours, they are my own. I will get down on my knees, and I will pray. I will get down on my knees, and I will pray. I will get down on my knees, and I will pray. My hands are small, I know, but they're not yours, they are my own. But they're not yours, they are my own, and I am never broken. We are never broken. We are God's eyes, God's hand, God's heart. We are God's eyes, God's hand. We are God's mind, God's eyes. We are God's hand.
Good morning. I am Rose Quirk, and I have been asked to do a minute for mission. You might wonder, golly, has the welcome table disappeared? What are we doing with the help that we gave to the community prior to the pandemic? Well, let me tell you, the welcome table has been represented along with the church and this congregation in an organization that was formed by a woman by the name of Phyllis Lake in Fishkill. It's a Dutch Reformed church. She has formed this coalition of multi-denominational churches to try to aid and ease the hard things that homeless folks deal with on a daily basis. Throughout the pandemic, we've been hard at work trying to feed these people with food bags that were handed out to them by local police in Fishkill when they were come across, or that they were getting from individuals that were driving around the town. There were cans in the back of the police station, I believe it was last winter, where these folks had electricity and heat so that they could stay warm if they so chose, because as we know, a lot of them don't want to go to the shelters in Poughkeepsie. They're afraid they're going to be put in a hospital or something of that nature. So we're trying to keep them close to home. Recently, though, as the world starts to open up again, we have been able to expand in even more directions. So last month, we gave 108 bags of food out to individuals, which is phenomenal as far as I'm concerned. New program. They are going to have laundry done once a week if they choose. They will have a laundry bag supplied by the laundromat. We will deliver them to the laundromat. There will be a 24-hour turnaround, and these guys will have clean clothes. It's amazing because this is going to allow them to actually maybe feel a little bit better about trying to find that job and feel a little less alienated out in society because their clothes are clean and they don't look so shabby, you know, worn and such. Also, we are working on a mobile shower, like a tractor trailer thing that they use in, you know, disaster areas, or in the military, I think, uses them as well. And once a week, be rolling into the town, and these guys who don't have the ability to get cleaned up will have the ability to take a shower and shave and, yeah, have their laundry done. Here's another great way to get them back into the workforce, because they're going to look presentable and they're going to feel good about themselves. Also, we are looking for addresses, places where these individuals can have mail sent. It'd be nice to have one in Beacon as well as in Fishkill, and wherever else we find communities as we go along that need it. In this way, they would be able to have one, correspondence with their families, two, apply for assistance in different programs that without an address, you cannot do that, and bring them back to where they should be in this world, and to not feel like such outcasts. They're kind of like in exile being homeless, if you ask me. Nobody wants anything to do with them. Nobody cares, really. But it's important that they know people do care and that we, you know, they want to help. God works behind the scenes for each and every one of us in our lives. You know, just like he did with Esther. Nobody could see him. Nobody knew what the deal was, but he was working through Esther to get his job done. You know, always follow follow that little voice in your ear. Do what it tells you to do. It's God asking you to do his work. So, yeah, keep the faith just like we are. And let's do good in the world. And love everyone. Never, ever, ever do any harm.
Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Barrier, Life Giver, Source of all that is and that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by the peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen.
As always, if there's any way First Presbyterian can be of assistance to you, please contact the church office at office@beaconpresbychurch.org or call 845-831-5322. And if you would like to support the ongoing ministry of First Presbyterian Church, you can send a donation to 50 Liberty Street, Beacon, New York, 12508, or give an online contribution through our website, beaconpresbychurch.org. Stay connected to the life and people of FPC by joining our First Presby Community Facebook group, as well as sign up to receive our weekly email newsletter. And now, a blessing. May you be at peace wherever you are. Remember those who are out in the world. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And wherever you are, may the love of God, the faith of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. And let all God's people say, Amen.